Can you tell me a little bit about Gwen Ifill and Judy Woodruff, what you learned from them and how you met them? And
I thank them so much that they proved that two women could, that used to be it, remember, there were no two women anchor teams, mm-hmm. that two women could work together, two women could be taken as credible, two women could be excellent at what they did. They fulfilled, you know, all of your visions for what you hope it will be like when they forget, you know, whether you were, I can't even say skirt or slacks that day, but and they got along. I mean, they were totally different in terms of personality, at least what I saw of them, mm-hmm. and but they were friends, and that was great. And when I really, it's in my more recent history, when I really realized what a good friend I had, when I finally wrote a book and I had my first book signing party, and I don't know how I got the nerve to do it, and I called Judy Woodruff and I said, Judy, would you fly out to California to interview me on stage for my book? And there was a pause, and she said, yes. Now I'll have to do a red eye, she said. I won't be able to stay, but I'll do it. And she did. Now, what more can you ask of a friend?
What are some of your favorite memories of the Presidio?
I think it's the sheer beauty of the place. It is the sheer beauty of the place. It is also the fact that it's been here for a long, long time. And then if you look at the Golden Gate and then imagine it without that bridge, if you imagine those first ships that came into that huge bay, I mean, what must they have thought?
But everybody pretty much knew that Letterman Army Medical Center was not going to be a hospital for very long, much less a medical center. At one point, I was given an assignment to go to the local employment development department office to gather workforce, like San Francisco workforce statistics. And the idea was that we had to do impact studies, and being the civilian most personnel-ish in the Army hospital, I was the one selected to do that. Do not tell them what you're doing for this for, but the basic idea was, what would be the impact on the civilian economy if so many hundred civilian jobs went up in smoke? So I had to go and ask for this information. But I did my best to tell them, I'm doing this because I'm on official business from the United States Army Presidio at Letterman, and somebody eventually, very quickly, somebody in the EDD said, apparently, you know, there's this guy trying to get, you know, workforce data from the Presidio. So it hit the news very quickly. And then I think because of the embarrassment that I didn't cause directly, the Army was forced to back off of its planned closure of the hospital for a bit longer.
The trouble is that certain slogans become popular, and as a result, they may distort understanding of what the real problems are. What we need certain rules. The regulation has become a pejorative word, so let's not talk about regulation. But what you do need is appropriate rules. And it's hard, and this is a very hard problem. You can see how hard a problem it is if you simply study the evolution of formally organized markets over a period of about 200 years, and how the rules have varied and changed, and how they have dealt with the problems that came up. And some of them were good rules, and some of them were bad rules. But to say that regulation is bad is simply stupid. What you want to know, what you're trying to do, is to figure out what rules should be. But then I think it's also important to recognize that there are circumstances when you have to rely on people's judgment.
Chicano studies, and by extension, ethnic studies in general, has allowed us to see a diversity in the American experience where my generation growing up in public schools had no inkling of whatsoever. And it's now beginning to penetrate the public schools and textbooks. Mm-hmm. Still slow to do, but it is. And that for me is social change as well. So what kids write and read and write about in high school, certainly in college, that it's expanding our understanding of what the American past and, by extension, what the American present is about, right?
So I picked it up, and a voice on the line says, could you hold, please, for Mr. James Leach, the chairman of the National Endowment for the Humanities? I said, yeah, okay. And I said, but I can only, I'm late for class. I can only hold for just a minute. And she said, he'll be right on. So Jim Leach comes on, and Jim says, Professor Saldivar, I'm calling at the behest of President Barack Obama, who wants to invite you to come to the White House. And I said, I really literally said this. I think you got the wrong number. Who are you trying to reach? And he said, no, I don't have the wrong number. This is, I'm calling to tell you that you've been awarded the National Humanities Medal. And so.
I looked at the wine industry and said, okay, what does the wine industry need? And I said, you've got all these guys growing grapes, you have all these guys making wine. And I also, because of the interest in French wines in particular, and having made some just, personal trips to France, realized that what was missing, I thought was missing in California, was the concept of people growing wine. So that the person who's in the vineyard, every operation they do, has a focus on how that's going to impact the wine. I said, Europeans get it. But in California, we're still very reductionist in the sense of these guys know how to grow grapes, these guys know how to make wine. When they try to talk to each other, the languages, there are a lot of missing pieces in the communication.
We like to judge things, and I'm saying in a positive way. Not everything is positive, but we like to judge things and with the potential that they might surprise us, that we figured that out. Which also reminds me, is a part of my excitement or whatever about winemaking, is that I'm kind of a little Sherlock Holmesy. You want to find out what's going on and how to fix it, kind of go down this path until you kind of figure it out and you look at the signs of things.
It was a divorced Catholic women's group. And I went out to visit them. Mm-hmm. They didn't meet in the church. They didn't have any parish that was local that would...
That would host them?
Host them, yeah. So they met at some bank or something.
Yeah.
And I went out, and I expected to be just socked, hard. Well, I had some experience of getting beaten up in the civil rights days too, but they were so nice to me, but they were really hurting when they tell their stories.
Yes,
it was very painful, and I couldn't do anything but listen.
Mm-hmm.
But they said they wanted to have a meeting, diocesan-wide, for the group, and I encouraged them.
Mm-hmm.
And I thought it was a very good idea.
Yes.
And I forget where they had it, but it was at at this time it was either at a school or one of the schools, and the leadership was very sensible. Oh, gee, they were good. And then, you know, priests got involved. And now this is the kind of thing, you've always got people who respond.
So by the time I came out of the seminary, I think I pretty well understood that priesthood was not a reward for having spent 11 years in the seminary, and was not some kind of special privilege, even though that's the way it was advertised. Mm-hmm. You're coming out as another Christ, and you're on a pedestal, and you know, you're different from other people. Mm-hmm. I came out with a sense of wanting to serve, and I think that was pretty well in place at that point. And wanting people to understand the faith as I was beginning to understand it, and to enjoy that rather than to spend their lives with guilt and fear.
As a freshman in college that summer, I went up to Yosemite with a friend who was going to get a job there. But actually, it was a really inspirational experience, and living, you know, in the tents and running the, as a sort of a tent cabin, still is, a, you know, a tent cabin, little kind of hotel. And we took off, you know, on our days off and hiked all over and climbed the mountains and hiked up, you know, climbed Half Dome and went down to the valley, and then the next week took a day and went down to the valley on the other side. And because of that experience, when I went back to Brown, everything looked upside down to me. Mm-hmm. And the, you know, the highest prestige jobs were things like nuclear physics, blowing up the world, and the lowest prestige jobs were taking care of kids. And at that point, it seemed this whole thing is upside down, and the values of so many people at that time in college just seemed totally upside down.
What made you decide to join the fire department as at the same time you were working as a ranger?
I like to tell the story that when I was at Don Castro as a temporary, there was a little grass fire, and one of the rangers drove a fire engine up, and he came up and he had these little glasses on, like John Lennon glasses, you know, gold rim, and he had a long ponytail down his back, tied in and tied up, and a little cap on, you know, and he was driving the truck, and I looked over and I said, you know, that's the kind of fire department I want to be in. So, at the time, I thought it would be kind of interesting because, you know, it's like your second job, and it looked kind of exciting, so I stuck with that for 30 years.
By 1973, it became a standard field trip with my classes. My major classes we would spend two or three weekends in the semester, and we were mapping the surface and having some access to the subsurface, because in the subsurface the rocks are fresh, and they just have all the detail that are often lacking at the surface. So when East Bay Regional Parks acquired it, I was delighted, so I didn't have to go to the ranches. I didn't have to worry about having access.
You know, in the same way that the civil rights issues from the 1960s, you know, there was a lot of religious people, priests and Catholic nuns and Christians who felt it was the right thing to do. There was also a lot of gay people who were played prominent roles in civil rights, even though they were closeted. But I know that it had to do with their connection to the idea of their own oppression, which then by the 70s everyone started to come out. And there was no different in the Chicano power movement. A lot of the Chicano artists were gay, you know, but people didn't feature it necessarily, or they were closeted. Members of Mecha, the Brown Berets, the student groups, you know, there were gay and bisexual and lesbian participants, but they were sort of on the down low or in the closet. And I was all about wanting to kind of blow that up and make sure that you know, our presence was documented and maybe even exploited. And I also had an element of wanting to be in your face. And I think it worked.
Very little. I've got to tell you some stories since this is what this is all about. The Athletic Study Center was featured in a Sports Illustrated article, and we were juxtaposed with, I think it was Clemson. And so we got some national mm-hmm. national exposure. Mm-hmm. We then became like this model.
Yeah.
Which emphasized the separation between academic support outside of athletics.
Right.
Yeah. And yet, you know, working to support intercollegiate.
Exactly.
Definitely a place for athletics on all college campuses, that it serves a tremendous role. And one of my goals was to prove that academics and top-ranked athletic teams can be done at the same school. Mm-hmm. I think right now it's the athletics is out of hand. I have no qualms at all of saying that. I don't think football coaches, and I don't mean to pick on them, or basketball coaches, should be getting paid more than the chancellors and the educators.
27 sports is a lot
it
for
is.
Cal.
It is. Absolutely.
I think it is, but Title IX mm-hmm. is impacting that to a certain extent.
Right.
I mean, the women took a hard rap when they kept saying
sure.
it was our fault that they had to drop men's sports, which was really tough.
Yeah, sure.
And that was
sure.
that was hard. It's too bad that they couldn't have helped us, because they could have.
Yeah. Sure.
So we had
sure.
to. We not only had to convince others, but to fight them, which made it even harder.
Yeah. Yeah. Exactly.
But we ended up getting a lot of respect. I think.
Mm-hmm.
I think people understood more about women's athletics.
Because it wasn't what he wanted to hear.
Yes.
You know, he wanted to hear
how you're going
to
help him
win football.
Exactly.
Right? And I was talking about how I'm going to identify early on people who could potentially become problems.
Uh-huh.
Right? And that we have a commitment, if we bring people here, to see them as a whole person. Mm-hmm. Right? So I was on that.
Yeah.
You know, train of thought.
Yes.
Because that's what I believed.
An organization has been put together at this point called Save UC.
Mm-hmm.
So stuff is starting to happen, and in the fall of 2009, things are heating up. And basically, meantime, there I am with my little athletics thing. And to be frank, this was not an accident. I actually thought to myself in a very deliberate fashion. I said, you know, I'm upset about this athletic stuff. I'm finding out real things that I don't think are right. I don't know whether or not my colleagues are sympathetic to my point of view. But you know, if there were ever a time that there might be, this is it.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm going to try to do something.
I mean, really, if you think about it from a local government perspective, and of course I was a local government official for 20 years, local government people were used to being in charge. And they would, you know, pay attention to the politics, and if people really hated something, maybe they would turn it down. But they didn't like the idea that, hey, gee, somebody else can tell us how to run the city or the county, that they can supersede our authority. Because the idea of local control through cities and county governments, that's a basic in California government. And the Coastal Act essentially said, wait a minute, the people of the state, acting initially through the initiative process, are going to set up some policies which you have to follow. You can't set your own policies. You've got to follow the statewide policies. And that was a revolution in terms of effective legal control over land use in the coastal zone.
I had some conversations with
more than one local city council person saying, thank God there's a coastal commission. I could do what I have to do politically in my city, and then you can do the right thing, and I don't have to take the heat.
After we've talked about the instrumental side of things, you write, the nation's interest in quality higher education is not limited to defense, economics, and technology. It resides as well on the softer qualities that are ingrained and absorbed on a campus, traits necessary to preserve and nourish a great society. Opportunity, diversity, citizenship, a cultivated fascination with the march of ideas, an appreciation for the grace notes of life, like a fine painting or a subtle poem.
Did I write that? That's well written.
It is. It is. And it's, I would say that I think it's very difficult to write like that and not mean it. So I want to ask you about that.
Well, it comes from my own life where education opened the doors. I've been like the rest of my family, probably an electrician and pretty happy middle-class family. Part of it is my experience in college and law school. I was not narrowly attuned to any specific career path, and I thought it served me well. I felt I learned a lot about human beings and about empathy, and I also think culture is important. It's the exogenetic heritage, not what's in your genes, but what you learn while you're living. And I always tell students who want to go to law school, I said, the first thing you do is I recommend you not take any law courses as an undergraduate. You'll have 3 years of it. And then I said, learn how to think, learn how to write, and take what interests you. I mean, I took Greek thought and astronomy for crying out loud. And most of my astronomy turned out to be wrong, so George Blumenthal tells me. But nonetheless, I enjoyed it at the time. So that's where that comes from. It has a liberating impact on the spirit, even if we can't guarantee a job. And we should try to get you jobs, but you miss the multiple dimensions. And the data, you can talk about cause and effect, but if you're looking at personal happiness and stable relationships and your health and civic participation, they all improve once you factor in the level of education.
Undergraduates weren't permitted to use Bancroft. That was something that I noticed when I first got here. It was not unusual for undergraduates not to have access to rare book and special collections libraries in that era. When I was in high school, I mentioned in the previous interview, I was invited to go to UCLA Special Collections for a day with the director of rare books. And he spent a whole Saturday with me showing me rare books, uncataloged books. It was a wonderful treat. Then when I went to graduate school at UCLA 5 years later, I discovered that library school students, which is I was one of those, and undergraduates weren't permitted to use special collections without special petition from a faculty member. And I got to Bancroft and it was the same. So I went to Jim Hart and said, I really think that undergraduates would benefit from having access to us. And his advice was wise. Why didn't you campaign with the younger reference librarians? Because the senior ones were not about to change the way they had always done it. So I did do that, and I think we were able to open up in 1972, 2 years after I got here. And so from that point on, we had undergraduate access, which is now normal, but it wasn't so normal then.
How often would you go to the library?
Every day, during the week, because that's when the guys were after me. Mm-hmm. And I ran there every day, at least for 2 or 3 weeks, and then I kept going for most of the school year because this was my friend, and this was a sort of a wonderful gift, really. That's why libraries are so important. Do you know who Michael Krasny is? Well, I was listening to a program maybe a year or so ago, and it was about what libraries meant to you as a refuge. And you can't believe the number of people who called in and said the same thing that I had said, that they found refuge there. And it was really a wonderful experience. So it was more heartening to me than it would be to most people, because I had lived the experience, you know. But I wasn't alone.